The classroom is now open. Brother Ashra Kwesi. Hotep, Brother Kwesi, welcome back to WOL Radio.
Hotep, Brother Carl, honored to be on your show as always, and here we are, right into another season.
The Easter season, help us out. How did this all start? Well, let me ask you the first question. Why isn't Easter on the same day as other holidays?
Well, that's a great question, Carl. You know, we know the last time, you know, we annually do the Easter and the birth of the Black Christ and the whole spiritual representation that our ancestors created thousands of years ago, literally based off of the sun. And we know that the sun is born out of the death of winter at December the 25th, and our ancestors saw that to keep that story alive through the great heroes and sheroes, we see that personified with Heru, who was born from his mother, Aset, that symbolizes Virgo. A lot of this is astrotheology, but unfortunately, our people are caught up in the stories that were taken from our ancestors, and now that was the winter solstice, now we're in the spring solstice. And the spring solstice is literally the resurrection, especially the bad winters that you have back east and the cold and snow and everything is barren. And now we see that the flowers are coming back, the days are longer and the sun is out longer and the flowers are blooming, the leaves are coming back to the trees. That is the resurrection of nature itself that our ancestors referred to as Mut Nechit. And these are spiritual stories that our ancestors told around this phenomena of the birth and the resurrection of the sun. And, of course, as I said, great heroes and sheroes played a personification with that. We are a very deeply spiritual people, and we created many spiritual stories that became part of the Western Judeo-Christian and Islamic culture. We can even add Buddhism, Krishna, and so on. But unfortunately, we get caught up in the mix, and we don't look at what's right in plain face and plain sight, and that is the spring solstice and resurrection. Now, in reference to your story, why isn't it the same day as December the 25th, or related to your question, why is it not the same time? Well, when we come into the spring solstice, and we now have moved from going into what is now called the spring equinox, and the reason why Easter is never on the same date, because it's based off of a moon holiday. Now, for those of us who know the ancient stories of Kemet or the Netters or the divine spiritual ones that we see or refer to as angels today, that was referred to as Tehuti. Tehuti represented the moon. Now, March 23rd will be the first full moon. How do we know when Easter is going to be? We know December the 25th is always December the 25th because that's the lowest point where the sun starts to resurrect out of the winter solstice. Now we're in the spring solstice. How we can tell, for those who have the calendars, you can still buy the calendars and has the various phases of the moon. You have the full moon, you have the new moon. March 23rd will be the full moon. Now, how you can tell it's the first full moon after the spring solstice, the first Sunday that'll follow will always be Easter. That's how you can tell. Go outside at night, you can see the moon is starting to go through its phases. It's going to get larger and larger. By March 23rd, it will be a full moon. By Easter Sunday, it'll be a complete full moon. That's how we can tell it'll be Easter. Follow the spring solstice, the first new moon. After the spring solstice, that first Sunday will always be Easter. That's why sometimes Easter is in April. Sometimes it's in March, various days, all corresponding to the resurrection. That resurrection is the spring solstice and the resurrection of Mut Nechit, that's the Kemetic word that we now call Mother Nature. And many stories are formulated around the spring solstice, just like when we were on the radio show, Carl, in December, we dealt with the Saturnalia and Santa Claus and all those stories that were also around the sun during the winter solstice. Now, what holiday do we have coming up? And that is, as we all know, that is the birth of Jesus and also Easter. Now, the question that when we look at the symbolism of Easter, and we see that, of course, I know when you were a child, Carl, and I was a child, we always look forward to those Easter baskets. We look forward to the Easter basket because it had chocolate in it, it had eggs in it, it had a chocolate rabbit in it, and we would go on an Easter egg hunt to look for these eggs. Generally, the eggs are colored various colors and so forth. So it was a very fun time. And so, of course, as children, we didn't ask any questions about the Easter egg or the chocolate bunny or none of those things. But now that we're adults, I think it's an intelligent question to start to ask, especially if our children start to ask us, why is there a bunny in the basket with eggs when a rabbit doesn't lay eggs? Okay, what is the connection? What does this all mean? Well, we have to go back to the Greeks. And we go back to the Greeks, how did they celebrate this time period known as the spring solstice? How did they think that new life came back to the earth? They saw it through fornication. And their idea was to get a Greek female. She would denude herself, take off all her clothes, and she would paint herself. And she would run and hide. The Greek males, they would go and look for her, hunt for her. When they found her, they would have all this sex. They thought that's how nature came back. They would also have bunnies. Why a rabbit? Why would they have a rabbit? Okay, they would have a rabbit because the rabbit is the one animal, it's the most fertile animal. And a rabbit, as we know, we have many, many litter. So this is how the rabbit became associated with Easter. So when we look at coloring eggs, taking white eggs that represented the European white female, okay, and you paint that egg, that symbolized when the white female, Greek female, when she painted herself. And then when you would hide that egg, that symbolized when the Greek males had to go on an Easter egg hunt, because they saw that is through how nature came back and resurrected, and they would have all this sex and fornication. So actually, it was a sex holiday. This is what we see. Now, the rabbit played a major role, because when we look at a rabbit, we see, again, the rabbit is chocolate. Now, it's known now that chocolate, when we see that when a lot of people do not get enough sex, they eat a lot of chocolate. So the rabbit is equally associated with sex through the chocolate rabbit and the eggs in the basket, symbolizing the Greek female. And one of the images of the Greek images of resurrection is Pam with a large erect penis. Okay, so here we see that is a corruption still of ancient Kemet. It represented the Setsu, or what is referred to as the Osirian resurrection. The Greeks never understood the real meaning of the resurrection. Our ancestors used symbolism, okay, not looking at it literally, but using symbolism of resurrection. So they had no problem showing the erect penis. So when you see the papyrus and you see the sun right above the penis, we see that what happens to males right before sunrise, they have an erection. So they were expressing a spiritual idea of the resurrection, but when the Greeks got it, they didn't understand it. They took it literally. Okay, they took the physical or the phallic as a literal resurrection that became, in the Greek culture, phallic worship. But it was not phallic worship in Kemet, it was just symbolism. It's the same phallic or penis that we see, and I know this is hard for a lot of people to understand, but you've got to go back and pay and turn back the pages of time, Brother Carl. So when we look
Hold that thought right there, Brother Kwesi. We've got to take a quick break, and I'll let you finish on this fascinating information about Easter. And as you mentioned, it may be tough for some people to swallow, this being Holy Week, Friday being Good Friday, and Resurrection Sunday or Easter Sunday being this Sunday. If you've got any questions about Easter, how it all started, it's a man you need to put it to. He's Professor Baba Kwesi. And we'll take your calls for him next after the traffic and weather update on 1450 WOL, where information is power.
Back to the Carl Nelson Show
on Washington, D.C.'s 1450.
1450 WOL Radio.
And thanks for staying with us, folks. And you can be polite. Or the classroom is now open. The master teacher is in session. 800-450-7876. That's how you raise your hand. Speak to Baba Kwesi. Tell us about Easter, how it all started, all these symbols, because they're not what they seem. So if some of you may rock your world because, you know, if you're like me, and as Brother Kwesi himself mentioned, we all grew up going into church, especially on Friday, Good Friday, sometimes for 3 hours, man. But now this is where it really all comes from. Brother Kwesi, I'm going to let you continue your story for us.
Right, yeah, so we were were talking about the rabbit and the eggs, and we were referring to why the rabbit is in the egg. Just a quick overview. Again, this is out of Greek Orpheus, where the Greek males would take off all their the Greek females would take off all their clothes and paint themselves and run and hide, and the Greek males would look for them, and they would have sex and fornication because they thought that's how the spring solstice came back, how nature came back and bloomed. And they used the rabbit because it's the most fertile of all the animals because of its litter. And again, when we look at the a rabbit is born with his eyes wide open, okay, when you see a rabbit born with his eyes wide open, that represents the full moon. As I said, March 23rd will be the full moon, and that's how we can tell when it's going to be Easter, because it's the first Sunday that falls the first full moon after the spring solstice. That's Easter, spring solstice, resurrection, and that's what it goes back to. So when I was talking about how the Greeks saw this around the whole resurrection, but a lot of it, some of it is a corruption of the spiritual stories that goes back into Kemet. And some who may not be familiar with Asar, and Asar is shown on the papyrus showing the erect phallus, but symbolizing his spiritual resurrection, where the Greeks took it literally. They saw the phallus or the penis, and it became phallic worship. So on their temples, okay, they would put the phallus right on their temples. Well, that eventually became the steeple of the church. So when you look at the steeple of the church and you see right below the steeple, there's always a sun. Okay, so right before sunrise, okay, is resurrection. That's when males get their erection. And then, of course, when we see those who are Christians, they go to church on Sunday and have sunrise service. So again, this is a corruption of the ancient spiritual stories of Kemet, but when we look at the symbolism around Easter and the bunny and so forth, all this stuff is coming out of Greek Orpheus. And we're getting our children ready with the Easter baskets, and they're going to go on the Easter egg hunt. And our children might ask us one day, you know, why aren't the eggs in a basket when a rabbit doesn't lay any eggs? So maybe some who may be hearing this can actually explain this to them. This is the real history behind the whole story. But when we look at this time period, it was a very spiritual time for our ancestors, a very spiritual time. Our ancestors going back thousands of years, and we have temples and monuments for many, many years now that I've returned back where these stories are carved in stone, where eventually, prior to the Europeans and other invasions coming in, they had thousands and thousands of papyruses, okay, that were plundered by the Greeks who came in, that told about the ancient spiritual stories that they observed around the forces of nature. It's the forces of nature that our ancestors saw connecting the terrestrial, meaning the earthly plane, and that well as the celestial, okay, the cosmic plane, and connecting these spiritual stories, that this is how we get a lot of these stories that now are formulated in human form. Unfortunately, they are represented as European images, which is a corruption. And we have to go back to the early Greeks who came into Africa, Brother Carl, and see that it's in Alexandria, where when we look at Alexander, okay, the second that our children are taught to call the great, nothing great about him. He's coming in as a plunderer. You got Aristotle's to plunder the sacred libraries and temples of ancient Kemet. These are great spiritual centers. Okay, not only was it based off of early education, spiritual, theological centers, and this is how the Greeks were introduced, or how they got an idea of many of the things that I'm actually talking about, when they housed this in the Alexandria Library after the Alexander's death. The Ptolemies came in, like Ptolemy the First, and they built this great library. We're all familiar with this Alexandria Library, but we don't ask any questions, where did all those sacred scrolls, where did they come from? When we look at the European Bibles, where was the first Bibles written at? And I say this all the time because this is critical. It's critical because why would Europe's first Bibles, why are they written in Egypt? They're written in Egypt because that is where the sacred knowledge that goes back countless thousands of years to predate Western Christianity, the Western world, Western civilization, by thousands of years. And they were there long enough with the Ptolemies, 300 years with them. And then when we see when the Romans came in, usurped the Ptolemies, and they came in for a period of time, about 400 years. And then we see the Byzantine Romans came in. So we're talking about almost 1,000 years of these Europeans who were able to study ancient spiritual stories that now become what is known as Western version of Christianity. Many people speak of Bibles. Many people speak of, most of the time, the Bible, as though there's only one Bible. But when we go back to Kemet, we go back to the land that is now called Egypt today, that our ancestors called it Kemet, that means black, we can see where these Bibles were written from the ancient spiritual and world's first sacred text. We are an ancient people. I think that we as a people suffer, Carl, because we refuse to unlock an ancient ancestral genetic memory bank that goes back thousands of years, that we continue to let ourselves stay within the circumference and worship within that circumference of European divinity or European, as they consider it, divine representation, when in fact the Europeans came and copied this black divinity directly from African people. And so through the presentations that I do around the country, not only during the time of Christmas, but also during the spring solstice, as well as Black History Month and other lectures, as you had a speaker on before me, again, this is why we are honored to always come on to keep our story alive, not just in Black History Month, but 365 days out of the year, so we can have time to and have the airways like you have to tell our story. When we look at Europe's first Bible that I spoke of, like the Septuagint version of the Bible, and we look at the early African Latin Vulgate version of the Bible. Okay, this is the African Latin Vulgate version of the Bible. It's from the African Latin Vulgate version of the Bible. That's how the Europeans got the European, okay, Latin version of the Bible from the African Bible. So these are some of the things that we are not researching when we look at how did the New Testament come about. How did Pope Damasus, okay, got Eusebius Hieronymus, okay, to write the new translation of the Bible that became the St. Jerome's version of the Bible. When we look at this story around Christmas, around Easter, excuse me, and we see, even though you got the bunny in the picture, you got it, a whole story around the resurrection, around the resurrection of this European image of a Jesus. And this is the foundation of the Western version of Christianity. And I prefer to call it the Serapis Jesus, because at these ecumenical conferences that Europeans had, okay, from copying the ancient spiritual stories of African people, the Kemetic Africans of the Nile Valley, that enabled them to formulate these ecumenical conferences into making a Western version of Christianity. And like the Conference of Nicene in 325 AD, this is where they came together and started to create the resurrection story and created this. Jesus is Greek, by the way. Now, when we understand the early stories of the Christ and with the Christ...
Oh, wait a second. Back that up a second, Brother Kwesi. You're saying that Jesus is Greek? Because some people are saying that Jesus is black.
Anyone can go to any Bible dictionary.
So Jesus isn't black then?
Well, I'm talking about the name Jesus. The name Jesus is Greek. Now, were there revolutionaries back there who were fighting the Romans? Yes, there were. Okay. Now, when we're talking about this whole resurrection story, born of a virgin birth, okay, during the time of December, this is a corruption. This is stolen from ancient African spiritual knowledge. It's stolen from the story of Asar, Aset, and Heru. Here we see the world's first holy birth, where Aset gave a holy birth to her child, Heru, born of Immaculate Conception. We go to the world's first holy city called Abtu, now called Abydos today. There you see the world carved in stone, the holy birth, where Aset is impregnated. And there you see the Madonna and Child at her temple of Aset, where the Theodosius and Justinian tried to chisel her out, but you still see the print of the first holy birth. So that black Madonna that they worship, that is Aset that they worship in the Vatican and throughout Europe. Now, when you look at the Jesus character that they have given us, okay, which is a corruption of the ancient spiritual story. Now, were there people who were out fighting the Romans? Yes. Who were these early African Christians who the Romans exterminated? Who were the ones who were really trying to teach us about what the Christ is, what the Christ represents? And these were the Gnostics. And the Gnostics said the Christ had nothing to do with a man. It had nothing to do with a carnalized image. The Christ represents a spiritual development in all of us. That means that we can all develop and rise up our Ka, that's the real name of it, and the Medunetra, the Ka, meaning the spirit, who the Gnostics called the Kores, who the Romans called the Christ, to rise up our spirit, to fight against tyranny and oppression. this is what the Romans feared. So they created out of this one character, from a character that was started by the Ptolemies, and that is Serapis. Serapis is a character that was started by them because the Kemetic Africans refused to accept the Ptolemies on the throne when they usurped it from the indigenous African rulers, and that's the Kemetic Africans of the Nile Valley. So this Serapis was passed on into the Roman culture. And they said, well, we'll make a Christ for them because, again, the Romans didn't understand spirituality. It's back to what I said about the Greeks. They took the phallics literally, okay, the resurrection. The Romans equally took the physical body literally. So in Kemet, the wrapping up of the mummy, when you go to the West Bank and you see 63 tombs there, Carl, nothing like it on the planet Earth. Some of them 3 football fields like Seti I of the 19th dynasty.
Right. Hold that thought right there, Brother Kwesi. You got to take another quick break. I'll let you pick it up on the other side. Folks, you too can join the conversation in this classroom. Just raise your hand at 800-450-7876. All of your calls coming next on 1450 WOL, where information is power.
Back to the Carl Nelson Show.
On Washington, D.C.'s 1450.
1450 WOL Radio.
And thanks for staying with us and our guest, the master teacher himself, Ashra Kwesi, discussing Easter and all the symbolism that we see in Easter. Before we go back to Brother Kwesi, just remind you folks who saw The Passion on Fox on Sunday. It's a musical about Jesus. It was hosted by Tyler Perry, and it just tanked in the ratings. So maybe people are becoming more aware. Brother Kwesi, I'm going to let you finish your story.
Yeah, as I was saying, Carl, our African ancestors, okay, of the Nile Valley, when we look at the whole resurrection story, they built great monuments and temples up and down the Nile, long before the Western world and Western religions was even in existence. Like, for instance, let's go to the West Bank. Let's go to the Valley of the Kings. And let's go here because this is where the Europeans got many ideas of the resurrection from. Here are 63 tombs there where our ancestors mummified the body for the spiritual resurrection. And that's during the 18th dynasty. And mind you, that even goes back to an earlier period, to the Old Kingdom, where our ancestors, as I talked about on many occasions, in an area called Saqqara. I know we know about Rome. We know about the Parthenon and the Vatican and all these places. But let's go to places like Saqqara and to Teti's tomb, and you see the Medunecer of the resurrection and salvation in the earliest language called the Medunecer, long before Aramaic, long before Hebrew, Arabic, and all these other languages. And here we see the whole spiritual story of the earliest idea of resurrection and salvation. And during the 18th dynasty, they're no longer building pyramids. They're actually building down into the earth 3 football fields, like Seti I. I mean, nothing like it on the planet Earth. Now, why did they mummify the body? They mummified the body because our ancestors saw that it's like a caterpillar, or like a cocoon. I think a cocoon is called a caress, okay? Here, this was called the caressing of the body for a spiritual metamorphosis, for the ka, meaning the spirit, and the ba, meaning the soul, to leave the body. But it's the kat, or the physical body, that stayed on earth. But once that ka, meaning the spirit, and the ba, meaning the soul, united together, then it becomes a sahu. What is a sahu? A spiritual body. This is what the Romans didn't understand, and the Western version of Christianity still don't understand. They saw it as a spiritual resurrection that would take place. And that's why when you look at the pictures of the European Serapis image of the Jesus, why are they wrapping him up like a mummy? If he's going to resurrect in a physical body, as we are told that when Mary Magdalene, she's the only one that saw the resurrection, okay? Supposedly, that's the way the story is told, that he resurrects from the sarcophagus, okay? And he says that I'm not a ghost. You can feel me. You can see that I'm flesh and blood, all right? That's what we are told through the stories that's passed down. But if he's going to resurrect, why are you wrapping him up like a mummy? Because that idea is copied. When you parallel the images of the European Jesus with the mummies of Kemet, it's the same exact swathing that they use, because it was a symbolic for the caressing and the spiritual resurrection, because our ancestors saw it like nature again, like something like a caterpillar that crawls on the ground, and all of a sudden it forms into a cocoon. And through this cocoon, a metamorphosis takes place, Carl. And that which once crawled on the ground now takes flight. That's how our ancestors saw that we would do through a spiritual resurrection, through the metamorphosis of the body, through the mummification. That's why the Western version of Christianity imagery that they have of the Serapis Jesus and the mummy was copied from directly from ancient Kemet. So these ideas, when we go into Kemet and see the spiritual ideas, when you go to King Tutankhamun's tomb and you look at the opening of the mouth ceremony, the opening of the mouth ceremony is very important. And King Tutankhamun, even though he had the smallest tomb in the Valley of the King, he became famous because his tomb, as we know, is the only one intact. Okay, so that's where we were able to see all the gold and the riches and gold shrines and three gold shrines they had to go through, three gold sarcophagus, and they finally got to his cot, meaning his physical body is still there, okay? But it's the spiritual body that resurrected, all right? And they understood that, so that's why they mummified the body. But the scenes on the wall is called the opening of the mouth ceremony. What is this opening of the mouth ceremony? The opening of the mouth ceremony goes, it's like this. Here the Sim priest is enable King Tutankhamun to see again, to talk again, where he's raised from the dead. And there you see Asar, the Lord of the Perfect Black, on the tombs. Just what Europeans see, this black divinity on the tomb, King Tutankhamun is becoming one with his Ka, his spirit, who the Nazis call the Christ, the Caress, who the Romans didn't understand it and called the Christ. Interesting enough, this spiritual black divinity is called the Christ. And there we see that in the afterlife, they're not speaking of this life for him to see, but in the spiritual life for him to see again, to talk again, to hear again, where he's raised from the dead. So the stories that we get with Jesus, where he made one, he raised them from the dead. He made one see again. He made one talk again. He made one see. This is literally taken from the spiritual stories that African people, who are the most spiritual people on the planet Earth, that's how the stories are there, from the tombs to give validation to it, from the opening of the mouth ceremony, where King Tutankhamun is now raised for him to live again in the afterlife. Let's go to the Temple of Heru. For many, many years, over three decades now, studying these reliefs and studying these tombs, and where many of the group members gasp when I do the comparison, when I take the images of Raphael and Leonardo da Vinci and these Europeans who came and copied these stories, and I take their pictures and put it right next to the relief. And what's breathtaking about this fact is that here you see the Sahu that I talked about a minute ago, the spiritual body. Now here you have one leg down and one leg up, and they have two arms up. So he's called the Dancing Ka. That means he is the, as we would interpret it today, the Dancing Christ. Why is he dancing? Because he's in the afterlife. He's in the spiritual realm now. He no longer has the swathing on. He no longer has the mummy on because his physical body, called the cot, stayed on earth. But it's his spiritual body, through the opening of the mouth ceremony, for one to see again, talk again, raised from the dead, that he's now a living ka, okay, in the afterlife. So this is why he's got one leg down and two arms up, okay, because he's free. Oh, wait a minute. Here we see the same representation by Leonardo da Vinci and Raphael. Here we see the Dancing Christ, the same exact picture that we see of this European Serapis Jesus, known as the Dancing Christ, and the most famous picture of him, of Raphael, where he's got one leg down and his arms up, and I put that picture right next to the relief, and even Europeans who happen to be passing by, oh, look at that. Look what he's showing, because they don't even notice it, okay, because they're not studying the reliefs. They're going there, and they're taught that it's pagan, it's heathen, and all these negative things. So there's a blockage to even see. That's why the church put that negative pagan and heathen in there, so the people could not see that this is where the original story came from, and they can see where they were able to copy many of these ideas from. So they did not want the people to see that. So Kemet, as well as other spiritual systems of Africa, got all these negative terms and all these negative connotations that justified their white supremacy Christianity and the enslaving of African people because we didn't have anything worthwhile. But it's only until we go back here, Brother Carl, and see where these ideas were taken from, and that's why the Gnostics were a threat to the Romans. They were a threat because the Gnostics knew that the Romans were stealing all of this and corrupting it and turning it into many of the European stories that we know in the Western world today. Even the idea that when we look at Jesus cut on the side, where he's cut on the side, oh, Carl, you know when they unwrapped the mummies and the first thing they saw on when they unwrapped many of the mummies in Kemet, that all of them had a scar on the side? The scar is on the side because that's where the organs were taken out from. So here we see the Roman. I mean, this is why Kemet cannot, the secret knowledge and the secret spiritual stories of Kemet has been a fear, okay, in the Western church. That's why during the time of the Dark Ages, as they called it, anyone talking this knowledge, as I'm talking now, the Inquisitioners, during the Inquisition period, would burn them at the stake because they feared that the people could see that the Western world came and copied many of these spiritual ideas directly from Kemet. And when you have people and some of their own, like the Catholic Jesuit priest, like Ignatius Kessner, who they started talking, when they started studying Kemet and started to saying that the Catholic Church stole many spiritual ideas and wisdom and the salvation and understanding directly from ancient Egypt. And people like Giordano Bruno, who equally said that Kemet was Egypt, ancient Egypt was the most spiritual place on the planet Earth. It's the foundation of our ideas of salvation and resurrection and many ideas that the Western Church got from there. That's what they took and set up and called in the Inquisitioners and burned him right there in St. Peter's Square. And there's a great big old statue of Giordano Bruno to this day holding a book. He's holding a book because that book represents the sacred knowledge of ancient Kemet, the sacred knowledge that they refer to as the Hermetic text. It's through the Hermetic knowledge of ancient Kemet that the Western world awakened, their sciences awakened, their religion awakened through that knowledge. So that big statue of him is there holding this book because of the wisdom that he was trying to teach during the Dark Ages when they burned him at the stake, when he was saying that the Catholic Church, okay, stole this knowledge from ancient Egypt. And this is the importance of us understanding when we start to come up into these holidays and start to, you know, we've got to have the freedom to think, all right? Because if you don't have the freedom to think, then we still find ourselves in the worst form of enslavement, which is in spiritual enslavement, when the enemy becomes the deity in the spiritual subconscious of our mind. And what I mean by that, if your representation of your divinity and your divine representation looks like Europeans, this is where the enemy has become the deity because they took away our divinity.
All right, hold that thought right there, Doc, because we're going to take a quick break. We'll look at the traffic. And when you come back, I want you to talk about the 3 days, because they said that Christ was crucified and that he rose on the third day. Where did that story come from? Folks, you too can join our conversation, 800-450-7876. This is the master teacher, Ashra Kwesi. He's in the classroom. He'll call us next on 1450 WOL, where information is power.
And now back to the Carl Nelson Show.
On Washington, D.C.'s 1450.
1450 WOL Radio.
And thanks for staying with us, folks. Getting an education here on the Easter season and a lot on religion and where it all started in Kemet. Our guest is the master teacher himself, Brother Ashra Kwesi. Again, let's go back to our guest, Brother Ashra Kwesi. And Brother Kwesi, they tell me that Cynthia McKinney may be giving us a call later on this evening, so we'll keep a lookout for that. But I'll let you finish your answer to my question that I asked you before the break. I'll let you finish up what you were saying, though. The resurrection, the 3 days that Christ was put on the cross, and the significance of the cross as well. Where did that all come from? And then the third day he rose again.
Yes, Carl. As I started the program, and I said that from the very start that this is all based off of a solar as well as a lunar event. Lunar meaning the time of the 23rd, that's the full moon, and then that's how you can tell the first Sunday is Easter, because after the first full moon after the spring solstice. And again, when you talked about the third day, again, that represents right before the sun crosses the equator. Now, you spoke of the cross. The cross is an ancient Kemetic symbol that was corrupted by the Romans. The cross, when we see today, meaning that the resurrection of the sun on the third day, or resurrection, if they say, of Jesus on the third day, why do you always see a circle? Have you ever seen a circle in the middle of the cross, Carl?
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah.
I can hardly hear you. I didn't know.
Yeah.
Oh, you said yeah. Okay.
Right.
Yeah. That represents the sun crossing the equator. That's why we see that now. Think of the European image that we have of Jesus. Why do you always have a sun behind his head? You see the image of the Jesus with the sun behind his head?
Mm-hmm.
Do you see the image of the cross equally in back of his head?
Right.
See the circle? Now, all they did was took the sun out and put a European face of a Jesus in there. So here we see the powerful force, at least in our solar system, that gives us life, the sun itself. They literally put a European image in there in placement of the sun itself, when that's a cosmic event of the resurrection of the sun on the third day. This is what it goes back to. That's why I find it interesting in Psalms chapter 84, verse 11, it says, for the Lord God is a sun. It didn't say S-O-N. Anyone can look that up. It says S-U-N, for the Lord God is a sun. Now, the cross, equally interesting. How did our ancestors use the cross? I show our groups every year the cross on the temples of Kemet. The cross had nothing to do with human sacrifice. The cross was called the Amsu. The Amsu represented the spiritual resurrection. When you look at the swathing that we refer to, as the Western world refer to as the mummy today, it always has a cross on the mummy, okay, or the cot, okay, the physical body. Why do they have the cross on the cot? That cross, as well as you see on the temples, it means Amsu. It represents a spiritual resurrection. And in the Medunetra term, it's called the Ka'ank. Ka'ank. Generally, you see two arms up and a symbol of the Ankh, the symbol for life, in the middle of it. Ka'ank means spiritual life. That's what it represents. And the cross represents that spiritual life. That's the origin of the cross and where the cross came from. The cross didn't become a symbol of Christianity in the Western world until 431 AD. That's when they start putting the crosses and the symbols and so forth, when in fact in ancient Kemet it represents the spiritual resurrection. As I said before, the Romans didn't understand nothing about the spiritual resurrection. Ideas of pictorial images and representations that we get, as I said, of Raphael, the transfiguration or transformation, all these things are coming from the ancient temples of Kemet. That's why I refer to them as the books in stone. Even though the papyruses are not there, even though thousands of these papyruses are in the cellar of the Vatican and spread throughout the European museums throughout the world, but our ancestors carved on the temples and tombs as though they knew that one day we would forget our story. And this is what we have to go back to understanding the Western version of Christianity. And many people get upset and get up arms. We're literally getting mad, Carl, at our own spiritual knowledge that was corrupted by the Europeans. This knowledge is our knowledge, but corrupted. What part of it, and the worst part of it, has been corrupted, is our divinity. Why did they create the negative black images and the negative things about black devil's food cake, angel's food cake? They saw the black images of Asar, the lord of the perfect black, on the temples. They saw the images and representation on all the temples showing the spiritual realm is black. They saw Amun, that we still say at the end of our prayers, okay, that represents the invisible spirit in all of us, the invisible spirit that permeates throughout all the universe, that the Greeks took up out of Africa and became part of the ending of the prayer of the church, that anyone that can go to the Timothy chapter 6, and it talks about whom no man can see or has seen, to whom be the honor and everlasting power, Amun, in Timothy chapter 6, verse 16. This is a jet black deity or God, and now physicists are telling us invisible energy that they call dark matter? What did these Kari Hebs, as they were called, priests, knew about the spiritual realm that the Europeans in this Western world are now just starting to tap in on, but still don't understand the spiritual representation? So here we see this black divinity, Amun, that we say at the end of our prayers and have no idea that Amun stayed part of their prayers in the Western world. But because of the vicious attack down through the millennials on our divinity that created such a hatred towards our spirituality, that we have rejected it because the Europeans made sure that they planted deep in our psychic and our spirit pagan and heathen and all types of negative things, that we are afraid to deal with this knowledge. But all we have to do is start to ask questions the very book that we refer to as the Bible, why was that book written in Egypt? That's a fundamental question, Carl. How did the Hebrew Bible, why was it written in Egypt? And here we got the Passover. That's coming up. Again, that's representing a solar event, too. That's the sun passing over the equator. Why is it that they had to sacrifice the ram or the lamb? Isn't the time of the Passover during the time of Aries? Isn't the symbol of Aries a ram, a lamb-type animal? That's the sun in the constellation of Aries. That's the sun passing over the equator. There's no documentation of any Jews passing out of Egypt. There is a story of Neferuadmos, who opened up the 18th dynasty, known as the Third Golden Age, and expelled some invaders called the Hyksos up out of Kemet. Here, the Hyksos invaded Kemet coming from a place called Mitanni, present-day Iraq, and held the delta in Egypt, known as Lower Egypt, in the north for 200 years until Neferuadmos expelled them, first starting with his father, Sekenenretau. And he lost his life on the battlefield. That's the only story of a large group of people being expelled, and it was Neferuadmos expelled them. And even Josephus, who lived around 37 to 100 A.D., said they took from Atmos, a real person, not a mystical person, and made a Moses. And then we get this story that he got the laws from the top of Mount Sinai. Here, and going on all the tombs that I talked about earlier, to go into the spiritual realm, you had to know the laws of Ma'at, meaning your moral behavior on earth as you lived on earth, okay? That you proclaimed it, I have not robbed, I have not stolen, I have not killed. 47 laws of Ma'at that you had to proclaim that you were right to go into the spiritual realm. They knew that you would have some bad deeds, but long as your good deeds outweighed your bad deeds on what they call the Hall of Ma'at. In the Hall of Ma'at, this is where we see justice, where your heart had to be weighed with the feather of Ma'at because your heart represented your moral behavior on earth. Isn't this where we get the idea you must be light-hearted from? Okay, from the feather of Ma'at? Once that was balanced with the African goddess Ma'at of truth, justice, and righteousness, then that enabled you to go into the spiritual realm, the laws of Ma'at. That later becomes the Ten Commandments. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not rob. Even though we took psychology classes, they never gave us Moses and monotheism by Sigmund Freud to talk about that Moses' monotheism or one God came from Kemet, his laws of Ma'at came from Kemet. And even if we go to the Bible, as I said, many of these spiritual stories were taken from Kemet and corrupted and ended up in the various Bibles down through the millennia, like, for instance, in Proverbs chapter 21, verse 1 and 3. And it says, the king's heart is in the hand of the Lord, and the Lord weighs the heart, do what is right and just. Isn't that Ma'at? Here are the scales of justice and the justice system equally have the symbolism of ancient Kemetic stories and spirituality, where we see blind justice holding the scales of Ma'at, where they replaced her with a white female with a rag around her eyes. And there you have to go into the courtroom. And just like in the Hall of Ma'at, you have to tell the Makaru. What is the Makaru? You must be truth of words in the Hall of Ma'at. Here you have to go into the witness stand, okay, and sit in a chair where you have to make sure that you're telling the truth. That's the law of Ma'at. That is the spiritual laws that was taken from ancient Kemet, the Makaru. We can go from one account after the other, even if you go and see in Psalms 89, verse 14, justice and judgment are the habitation of thy throne. That is the goddess Ma'at. You see her sitting on her throne in her feather. You see the kings, like Ursa Ma'at, Ra, September, Rama, Missile, Murray, Amun. I know we don't know these people. We know all these other, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and all the others. But here he's sitting on his scale, his throne. It represents Ma'at. And Washington, D.C., George Washington sits on the exact throne of our ancestors, Ursa Ma'at, Ra, September, Rama, Missile, Murray, Amun, where they copied the same idea equally with Abraham Lincoln sitting on the same throne of Ma'at. Carl, this is the fear. That's why they had to make up all kinds of stories about ancient Egypt. Tell black folks extraterrestrials did this. Tell them that some people from other lands, some Europeans did this. So they created all kinds of stories, even to the point of calling and saying, like Maspero on the second floor of the Cairo Museum, that's got a big plate there. He was the curator of the museum in the late 1800s, and that plate is still on the wall, saying he's Nick Roy, but not actually Nick Roe. And then as Charles G. Seligman, who said that, oh, they're black Caucasians. They see they're black, but we just got, let's say they're Caucasians. They know they stole this from ancient Kemet. We are stolen people, Carl. So it's an intelligent question to ask, that we are a stolen people. So the question to ask, what else has been stolen?
The question, the other question is why?
Why what?
Why did they steal it?
Because they had no spiritual system. These ideas, the making of the Western world and the Western, like I said, when they were in the Dark Ages, they didn't know anything about the whole heliocentric idea that the sun was in the center of the solar system. Imhotep knew it. All our children should know Imhotep. Every black man and woman walking this planet should know Imhotep. We know Galileo. We know Copernicus. We know Kepler. But Imhotep lived thousands of years before them, and he knew about the heliocentric idea by studying the winter solstice and summer solstice, giving us a 25,000-mile circumference of the earth long before the Athenian Eratosthenes, who studied in the Alexandria Library from those ancient scrolls. So this is knowledge that they didn't even know, because their idea was based off of a whole geocentric. It was the earth that was in the center of the solar system. So they were backwards in everything. So their awakening of the Western world, not only their religion, okay, but their sciences and the Western civilization awakened.
Right. Hold that thought right there, because I want to take a quick break. And Renee in D.C.'s got a question for you. You too can speak to the master teacher. I know you're getting an education today, folks. Ashra Kwesi is his name. Take your calls for him after this short break on 1450 WOL, where information is power.
Welcome to the Carl Nelson Show
on Washington, D.C.'s 1450 WOL radio and live around the world on WOLDCnews.com.
And thanks for rolling with us, folks, and our guest, the master teacher himself, Brother Ashra Kwesi. And it might be a lot for folks who are hearing this for the first time to digest, so I suggest that you get a copy of the podcast and play it back and then break it down, because he's connecting a lot of dots here, and I know he's moving quickly because it's a classroom setting, and for some people it's really blowing minds because they've never heard this stuff before. 800-450-7876. We're going to speak to Renee in a moment, but Brother Kwesi, I'm going to let you finish up what you were saying before we left for the break.
Yeah, I was saying so much there. I almost forgot what I said myself. But, you know, some of the other highlights with Easter is the baptism. You know, it was started in 418 by the Roman Catholic Church. And that was at the one of those ecumenical councils. Okay, now again, the baptism was taken from ancient Kemet. When you go into the greatest temple on the planet Earth called Ipetosut, dedicated to Amun that I just told you a minute ago, and here after 40 years of the Kari head priests going to school, not 4 years but 40 years, and they were baptized in their initiation. All right, and the baptism represented the amniotic fluid of the goddess Aset, okay, because, again, this is where your first baptism starts, in your mother's womb. That's what our ancestors saw. That's why the Ankh, okay, the Ankh is a symbol like a cross with a loop on it, symbolizes her uterus. That's why it was called the Ankh, or meaning life, or Neter Ankh, divine life, because it was her womb that was born from her womb. So your first baptism did not take place by the Catholic Church, who started in 418 A.D., and you had to be baptized because of your sins of your mother and father, because they had sex, because that story is a corruption, and it's a misogyny, going back to Adam and Eve, because they become aware of their sexuality as we get in this Western European version of the story, and because they had sex, and Eve, who tricked Adam to eat this fruit, okay, or whatever it's supposed to be, and then that's the reason for all the world's sins. So they tell us that we have to be baptized because of that event that took place right there. And then Adam is a snitch. He tailed on Eve because she became aware of his sexual organs or whatever, and they have sex, but on and on and on. But the real baptism is the amniotic fluid of our mother's womb.
All right. Well, that's all right there, Brother Kwesi. We have some people want to speak to you. 800-450-7876 is line one. Renee is calling us from D.C. Renee, you're on with Ashra Kwesi.
Hi. I'm in class today, and I'm really, really learning some things, and it's just great. And I would like him to make sure that we get the correct spelling of his name and his contact information. Well, when Brother Kwesi, when you were talking about the spirit going into spiritual realms, and something has really been troubling me, and it's how we're taught to accept so many things that are detrimental to our soul. And we're just taught to just think of it as really nothing. And because, you know, that's how they teach us. So one is accepting being a murderer, because sex is you know, is so loose, taught to be so loose these days, and people going to use choice. Is they say choice, but really call it murder. Cause that's
right.
Right.
Renee, put in a question for him so he can respond.
You're murdering your unborn child. So I wanted to know about the things that we are taught to do that are detrimental far as us going into the spiritual realm, how that's affecting us as a people, you know, as a person who accepts and does something like, some of the things that they teach us to do.
All right. I'll tell you what, and add on to that, Brother Kwesi. Renee, I thank you for your question. Brother Kwesi, tell us about heaven and hell. Is there such a place? Because that's what they teach us in Christianity, that there's a heaven and there's a hell. And basically, that's what they say is holding down a lot of black folks, because we've been told to do good here on earth, and then, we, you know, when we die, we're going to go to heaven. So how did our ancestors view that?
Well, unfortunately, this is what started in the Middle Ages, was these people out of their land, okay, during the landlords, okay, in the Middle Ages, and it worked so well, it passed down to the day during the time, if you don't give enough money and you tithe enough money to the church, they say you'll burn in hell, so you feel guilty and give up all your money, so you have a lot of preachers out there pimping people in the name of God out of their money, that they'll burn in hell, but during the Inquisition period, the Dark Ages, they burned you literally, okay. If they felt that you were a heretic, okay, like some of the people I talked about earlier. Whereas now they terrorize you by saying that there's a devil that's going to roast you forever and ever and put fear in you that if you don't go by their rules that you're going to burn in hell forever and ever. Now, in ancient Kemet, you did not have a devil roasting you forever and ever. You would the idea in terms of the laws of Ma'at, you cease to exist. You no longer can go on into eternal life. The Western version of it is a corruption of Amit, because Amit is the one that ate your heart. Your heart represents, when he ate your heart, you cease to exist in the hall of Ma'at. And Amit is a terrorized animal like a crocodile and a hippo, you know, and he's, you know, representing a combination of animals. But this is the idea of Satan, okay, comes from this idea, okay, but they turn it into that you'll burn forever and ever. So black folks know we went through a lot of hell through racism and white supremacy, so we definitely don't want to go through anything that could be worse than this. So many of us are terrorized through that concept of it, unfortunately.
All right, folks, I want you to listen, just listen with an open mind, because I know some folks are, you know, you're raised in the church and some of this stuff is, yeah, it's kind of new, and so it's blowing their mind. So just have an open mind.
Even though I was raised in the church, I think the knowledge is my own. I didn't follow anyone. I read it for myself and did research. First question is, you compared it to Western civilization, but isn't some books in the Bible, before they put it together, didn't they predate even Greece and the Roman Empire?
The voice is very low. I can hardly.
Okay, I'm going to take... I'm taking a headphone off. Okay, my question is about when you compare it to the Western civilization, right?
I've been doing that. I don't know what point you came in on the talk, but I've been doing a comparison throughout my whole talk here.
Didn't some books in the Old Testament, Torah or the Bible, didn't they predate the Roman and the Greece Empire and even before the Western civilization? Books in the Torah or the Bible, they were put together, I mean, before the Roman Empire even came into existence in Greece. So didn't those books predate the Western civilization you're talking about and comparing it to?
Are you talking about the Torah? The Torah, what's it go back to? 500?
And the books of prophecies, all those books from Hosea, Ezekiel, the rest.
Even that is interesting, that National Geographic came out, and it has King James Version of the Bible. What I found interesting about National Geographic, in fact, is with Dr. Ben, a little pamphlet that he put out a years ago on the chronology of the Bible, even though he wrote many books. But this one is very powerful because it's a little pamphlet given a chronology of the Bible, as many of us think of one Bible. National Geographic put out one of their magazines, and it has on it the King James Bible. But inside, what I found interesting, they showed all the origins, how far back it goes. And what did they start with? The Hebrew Bible is 500 B.C., okay, or B.C.E., before the Christian era. The Septuagint version of the Bible is 250 B.C.E., all right? Now, where were both of those Bibles written at? They were written in Egypt. The 72 priests of the Septuagint, the Septuagint is plagiarized from the Hebrew, but this is what people don't know, or some who don't ask the question, where did that Hebrew Bible come from? Now we're getting into what is referred to as Per Imaru, that Wallace Budge refers to as the Book of the Dead, because they were robbing the sacred scrolls of our ancestors of their salvation and resurrection into the afterlife. Some of the things that I just said, all the good things that they have done on earth, that their good deeds outweighed their bad deeds. This is the Per Imaru. I talked about Saqqara. There I talked about here the great tomb of Seti, his pyramid. There you see in the Medunetcher, as I show our groups every year, the salvation and resurrection. This is where our people know nothing about this. This is not taught in the seminary schools, as we don't have institutions to teach it, so we don't know it. We only know about a white seminary school, where they teach us a white theology. In many cases, the preachers, they come out to teach us a white theology, and in many cases teach us how to deify Europeans through this white theology. So, again, we got to go back. And many things that I'm talking about, even though the monuments and temples and is all there to validate it, is totally oblivious to us. So when you talk about the Hebrew Bible, that Bible starts about 500 BCE. 500 BCE, that is, Kemet is very, very old already.
Hang on a second, David. I know you have a second part of the question, and we've got to take a last look at traffic and weather for our folks in the DMV. Stay with us as well, Brother Casey. 800-450-7876. You too can join the conversation. Our guest is the master teacher himself, Brother Ashra Kwesi. Again, the number to call to reach him is 800-450-7876. All your calls coming next after the traffic and weather together right here on 1450 WOL, where information is power.
Back to the Carl Nelson Show
on Washington D.C.'s 1450.
1450 WOL Radio.
And thanks for staying with us, folks. Our guest is the master teacher himself, Brother Ashra Kwesi, telling us about what's going on with this Easter celebration that's coming up. And I know for some folks, it's probably mind-blowing because they've never heard some of this stuff before. But just think with an open mind. That's one thing I admonish you to. And also, Brother Kwesi, if you can shorten up on the answers, because there's a bunch of folks got questions for you. David, your second question for Brother Kwesi.
Two quick questions. One is one about the Book of Enoch, which they studied during Christ's time. Isn't that older than 500 years? And the second one is, since Egypt migrated from, like, the center of Africa, wasn't there more than one religion in Africa besides, you know, what you're talking about that came out of Egypt?
There were spiritual systems throughout the African continent, whether we're looking at the Yoruba system, whether we're looking at the system of the Dogon. These are ancient spiritual systems that are, when we look at the teachings of the Yoruba, and we look at the Orishas, and we look at the Netarus of ancient Kemet, the same stories are there. The names may be different. We see these migrations that went from east to west. When you even speak of the Yorubas, they speak of they came from the great river from the east. That great river is the Nile, the longest river in the world. Those spiritual systems that came not only did not – I'm dealing with Kemet because Kemet, we have the monuments and the temples to validate some of the things that I'm talking about. But the story goes much further back to Kemet. It goes deep into Kush. It goes deep into the Congo with the Twa. All right, so again, the spiritual system is throughout the African continent, known by many names, but it's the same spiritual ideas that started with African people that reached the zenith on the books in stone. When you look at the Zoop types, okay, and representations that our ancestors have, these Zoop types are not coming from Asia or Arabia or Europe. all these zoop types, it was not about animal worship either, by the way, but they represented spiritual representation, just like Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John are animals. But again, those zoop types in Kemet all are coming from inner Africa. It took countless thousands of years to develop before there was Judaism, Christianity, Islam, and that's what we can't understand because that's all we know. That's right. All we know. Enoch is no other than Imhotep. When we look at Taha, even in the Quran, Taha is Tahuti and Sora. When we look at the Hadith with Prophet Muhammad, we're told that Gabriel, the angel of the Lord, came to him, and that's how the Quran was written. Well, Gabriel is Tahuti. That is the spiritual netter of ancient Kemet. That now the equally that we see in Christianity. Gabriel, the angel of the Lord, that comes to Mary and says she's going to have a holy birth. Yes, the same story that Tahuti comes to a set and says that she's going to have a holy child. And that holy child is Haru. I show our groups on the release of monuments every year. Even Obama said, slavery was just 150 years ago. We only know what the slave master has taught us. The emancipation now starts from us stopping having the fear, but to go beyond this Western world. Start from the beginning. If you go to a riverbank, that's not the beginning of that river. Find out where the beginning of the river is, and then you start to study. But if you just study where the stagnant water is, that stench, and it smells because it's not the truth.
Right. Hold on a thought right there, Brother Kwesi. A bunch of folks want to reach you. 800-450-7876. Line 1, D's calling us from Baltimore. D, you're on with Ashra Kwesi.
Yes, good afternoon, Carl. Good afternoon, Brother Kwesi.
Good afternoon, my brother.
Yes. My question is, you mentioned Islam a little bit. Can you give a brief synopsis of when the so-called Arab came in with Islam and spread across North Africa and how that's kind of diverted our attention from Egypt because they think it's all about Islam and Muslims.
Again, when the Arabs came in between 639 to 641 A.D., the Arabs came in. Who was in Egypt at the time when the Arabs came in? Okay, those were the Romans. The Roman Byzantine Christians who have terrorized Kemet, copied many spiritual ideas that I'm talking about, incorporated into Western version and the making of the Byzantine Christian religion that led into Catholicism and all these other denominations that we got of Christianity today. The Arabs, equally, when they came into Alexandria, okay, they came in, even though some looked at them as mercenaries to fight the Romans who had inflicted so much havoc on them, okay, from the time of the Ptolemies. And in some cases, they looked at them as saviors, but again, if you're looking at someone fighting for you, they came in and equally took over and started to study many spiritual ideas, okay, from those scrolls that I talked about. This is what we've got to understand. All we have to do is look at the chronology and understand what was in Kemet and who was coming in and who was benefiting from that knowledge. And the Arabs have been there ever since. And many other invasions, from the Ottoman Turks, okay, to the French, okay, to the British, to the America. Everybody has plundered into ancient Kemet and has benefited from ancient Kemet. Now, when we look at when Islam refers to a Jahiliya, okay, like the Christians who call Kemet pagan and heathen, all right, to block our mind from the spiritual systems that was taken from there, the Arabs call it Jahiliya. Jahiliya is that there's no knowledge existed until the Prophet Muhammad. And it's sad to have children in Kemet who are sitting in school and can look out their window and see the great pyramid of Akhet Khufu built in the 4th dynasty, 2,500 years BCE, and then they're told, Jahiliya, no knowledge existed until the Prophet Muhammad. Wait a minute. The greatest structure on the planet Earth, here our ancestors using geodesics, building that structure in the center of the Earth. And yes, in the center of the Earth, because in England is not the center of the Earth, where they talk about the Greenwich. That's not the center of the Earth. When you look at geodesics, the center of the Earth is in Kemet. But the point is that children today in Egypt still don't know about the ancient knowledge of Egypt because it was blocked through religion as well. Right. Just like Christianity blocked the sacred knowledge and spirituality of Kemet through Christianity.
800-450-7878. Calling us from D.C. Robin, you have a question for Brother Ashra Kwesi.
Yes. Hi, how you doing this evening? My question, when you was mentioning about the spirit, and correct me because I know I'm kind of bad with the pronunciation, was it Imatu?
Demakaru, truth of words. Mm-hmm. Telling of the mock to be truth of words.
Can you repeat that one more time for me? I'm sorry, sir.
Maatkaru, M-A-A-T-K-E-R-U, Maatkaru.
Okay. And the reason I call is because it was a movie that came out about this guy meeting this lady, and they doing this treasury thing as far as archaeologists, science archaeologists over in Egypt and so forth. And one of the characters was that name, but they showed that if that was a bad spirit and it was coming back to do bad things to every person on earth. And it was just interesting for me to hear you had mentioned that. So that's not my question, but that was just
A lot of things that we see out there in the movies with the gods of Egypt that's out there now, which is a story corrupted from Kemet, where now they have two white guys, one playing Set, one playing Haru, and then Tahuti that I talked about earlier, even though they got him desecrated in some crazy image. But Tahuti, in the Battle of Kemet, the story is told where Set knocked out his right eye, and then it was Tahuti that gave the eye back, the all-seeing eye. That's the pineal gland, the spiritual consciousness and the spiritual awakening, that eye that's on the dollar bill, by the way, okay, that capstone, the all-seeing eye. That means a spiritual awakening. That's why you see that eye radiated on the dollar bill, the spiritual awakening. This is what they don't want us to have. But, again, they tell the stories in these movies, all right, just like in The Mummy recently, a few years
that's
back.
That's the movie.
Imhotep. He was called Imhotep. So our children here, Imhotep, they don't want to know about this multi-genius, the world's first multi-genius, who built the world's first stone building, who was a physician 2,000 years before Hippocrates, all right, the first world's first physician that I show our groups on the monuments, the medical instruments. But yet he's demonized and vilified in the movies as this demonic character, as this mummy. So they know this knowledge, so here they perpetrate these negative images on the psychic of our children.
Right.
Like myself, when I was a child, I was terrorized by the mummy of Boris Karloff and all that, so I didn't want nothing to do with Egypt. So again, they have the high technology today. Back then, they had the fear that you would be burned at the stake as heresy laws. So they do it through the movies today and still perpetuating all this madness, and that's why you see all these movies about the Bible and on and on.
All right. Thanks, Robbie. Thanks for your call. 800-450-7876. Keep moving. Let's go to line 3. Mike's with us, also calling from the district. Mike, your question for Brother Ashra Kwesi. Is Mike there? Mike is good. Let's go to line 5 then. Chuck, calling from Washington. Chuck, your question for Brother Ashra Kwesi.
Good evening. I have a simple question. Do we have any places of worship that actually worship with this belief system? Do we have any places of worship here in the States that are places of worship for this African, for our African, ancient African belief system?
Well, I travel around the country and lecture around the country at various places, and one place that stands out, I have to mention the Caress Spiritual Center in Los Angeles, which I have lectured there going back to the early 90s. And you notice I said Caress. Okay, that's what I talked about. That represents, as the Nazis call it, a spiritual resurrection that was corrupted by the Romans and took it literally. Now, that's one place I do know where they study the ancient Kemetic knowledge and the spiritual system. All right, there's not a lot of places around the country. Again, one of the things that areas that we suffer at is institutional building. All right, so I think for the fact that we have the airways like Carl Nelson's show that I'm on here to bring that awareness, okay? And I don't expect brothers and sisters to wake up today, but the fact that we're planting the seeds for today as we come out of this ma'afa, the ma'afa of slavery, we start to go through the final emancipation of our freedom. And that final emancipation starts with our mind, because that's what they enslaved. All right, they destroyed our history. They took away our names, as the brother was saying earlier. We weren't allowed to play the drum. They took away the drum, the communication, you know, our names that we got, everything about us. This is what made us slaves. In fact, a boy, they called us boys because we didn't know nothing beyond the master. All right.
Right. Hold that thought right there, Brother Kwesi. You got to take another quick break. 800-450-7876. Chuck, I thank you for your call. More calls next on 1450 WOL, where information is power.
Back
to the Carl Nelson Show.
On Washington, D.C.'s 1450.
1450 WOL Radio.
Thanks for staying with us. And the master teacher himself, Ashra Kwesi. And we've got a lot of folks who listen and never heard some of this stuff before. But again, I just appeal to you, just listen with an open mind. And anything that Brother Kwesi says, you can go and fact check it as well. And if you're interested, he takes tours to Egypt. I'll let him tell you about those. Because everything that he says, and if he's ever in your town, and he's having an event in your town, because he brings evidence, you know, he brings tapes and he brings all kind of artifacts to show what he's talking about. 800-450-7876. Mike is back with us in DC on line 3. Mike, your question for Brother Kwesi.
Yeah, how you doing, brother?
Doing fine, Brother Mike. How are you?
All right. I just have one question about like the origination of man. Where do you think like man came from? Do you believe in like evolution, or where did all this come from? If it didn't come from, you know, like Adam and Eve, that's what I was always told. Like, what's your opinion on that?
Well, we had another university, and unfortunately, we can't cover everything in one story. But again, like I said before, we're still locked within the Hebrew version of the Adam and Eve story, which is nothing but a misogyny story. This is a corruption of the ancient African spiritual story of Asar and Aset. Now, see, this is where the problem comes in, because we were not taught about Asar and Aset. Here, this is the world's first creation story, known as the Zeptepi. Asar and Aset story existed thousands of years before the Adam and Eve story. The difference is they were created simultaneously. There was no story that a rib was taken from the man, okay, to make Eve. Okay, the story did not exist, and the Kemetic story was based off of Ma'at. Ma'at is truth, justice, and righteousness, and balance. So the balance is they were created simultaneously. When the patriarchs came from the north, they created this Adam and Eve story, and that's how we got it. And as we know about the story, about the fact that Adam is Eve, and then they have a son named Cain and Abel, okay, and Cain kills Abel and goes out to the land of Nod and finds himself a wife, all right? Now, in the pictures, when you look at Adam and Eve, they both got navels. The only reason why we got navels is because of the umbilical cord. Somebody forgot to take the navel off of Adam in the picture. So, again, this is nothing but a hatred towards the woman. When we look at that Adam and Eve story, and the Kemetic story was not based off of that. So here, the Eve is referred to as the mother of the original sin, which is sexual intercourse, okay? This is some sick stuff. This is it's still part of the European culture, even with the Greeks, with the Pandora box, because he or she, all the evils of the world is in this Pandora's box. And so the Eve story is the same thing when she gets Adam to awaken to his sexuality. And supposedly they have sex, and because Eve is the one that brings the fruit to him, this is the reason for the world's sins, okay? That's a sick misogynist who wrote that. Now, unfortunately, that's all we know is Adam and Eve. They recently found in Ethiopia Adultu. Here, Adultu is a homo sapiens sapien. Even was on CNN of a skull of a family and a child and a man. Okay, name Adultu. 160,000 years. The Adam and Eve story, the biblical count is 6,000 years. That means Adultu is 154,000 years older than the Adam and Eve. And that's not to even mention Dekanesh, 3.1 million years. And coming from where? Africa, from the Hadar Valley of Ethiopia. So when we look at the anthropology, we see the early beginning. When we look at the spiritual stories, we find that early beginning in Africa. But unfortunately, the only story that we know, when that European gave us that Bible, when we got off those slave ships.
Keep listening, folks. And Brother Kwesi, like I said, a lot of folks are hearing a lot of this stuff for the first time. So it's going to take a while to digest. But basically what Brother Kwesi is saying, there was a whole world that was going on before the folks who wrote the Bible came into existence. And those people who were around were our ancestors. 800-450-7876. Clarence is joining us from the district. He's on line 4. Clarence, your question for Brother Kwesi.
Good evening, Brother Kwesi.
Good evening, brother.
Yes, I want to, you know, I applaud you, man, for your knowledge and your research. I got to say that I looked at a DVD called Hidden Colors, where there were some profound scholars, master teachers on Hidden Colors, who actually elevated my knowledge to another level, which allowed me to grab my sons and teach them the correct history of our people, because they're not getting it today in society. I know the sister called earlier, talked about a movie. A lot of the Europeans know the truth about our existence. but they have a way of using propaganda to water down the truth to keep us in the darkness and continue to keep us institutionalized, enslaved institutionally. You know, so I do appreciate what you're doing in terms of enlightening us. I receive you, man, open-heartedly. It don't take me a long time to receive that information because I know that there was an existence before the Europeans put together what we know as the Bible. Thanks again, my brother.
Okay. All right, thanks, Clarence. Let me ask you this question, Brother Kwesi, then. I thought Clarence was going to go there. So how was the first man created? Do we know?
Brother Carl, there's some things that we can never know, but let's look at anthropology. Where do we find the oldest human fossils? Does it start with the Java man of 500,000 years when Europeans did research there? They didn't even consider Africa. They were so racist, they didn't consider Africa to be the home of humanity. And they said, oh, it was the China man, the Java man. And then, you know, they started looking at other places. They even looked at Europe as being the home of humanity, but only to the leakies who let it all leak out. When they started to do research in the Adobe Gorge right there in Kenya, we're not dealing with thousands of years now, millions of years now. Johansson, the paleontologist, when they started to do research in the Adar Valley, Dikanesh, 3.1 million years. Then they started to deal with their science of mitochondrial DNA. The mitochondrial DNA validated the African spirituality around the goddess because here they traced all humanity back to one African female. Through mitochondrial DNA. It's our ancestors who drew from the whole spiritual goddess, which is the foundation. So that shows that they were right. Everything is coming from the mother, whereas the patriarchs did not see that matrilineal system. That's why their system was based off of misogyny. So let's deal with the sciences that we got in anthropology. You don't have any fossil finds nowhere on the planet Earth other than what you find on the African continent. None. So that's why Europeans have come up and now trying to come up with this polygenetic origin. And this polygenetic origin, what they're trying to say is that humanity sprang up simultaneously all over the planet Earth, although giving no scientific anthropological evidence to validate it. There's only one monogenetic origin, or meaning one origin, and that's from the fallopian tube. What fallopian tube? We're talking about the fallopian tube of the Happy Valley called the Nile today. We're talking about the Great Lakes regions around Tanzania, or Kenya, okay, the Congo, highlands of Ethiopia. Here you find the earliest fossils of humanity, and I started to deal with the Homo sapien adultu, who would be like us today, 160,000 years. Even though when we look at the early terms that they give anthropology, like the Australopithecus afarensis, okay, she would fall into the time period of 3.1 million years of these early hominids. But when we get into the Homo sapiens sapien to validate that these early grimaldis, like Adaltu, who migrated up out of Africa and migrated into Europe and migrated into Asia, I know it's hard for us to believe that one time the whole planet was an African planet.
Right. Hold that thought right there, Brother Kwesi. You got to take our last call. And Carl up in the Bronx, you're up next. 800-450-7876. You too can get online and speak to Brother Kwesi. Take your calls next as the big show rolls on from 1450 WOL, where information is power.
1450 WOL Radio.
And thanks for staying with us, folks. Brother Kwesi, you want to finish up what you're saying, or do you want another call?
If someone wants to go read on the books, I would get Africa, the Mother of Western Civilization by Dr. Yosef Benyakinen, that we affectionately know as Dr. Ben. And that's what we have to start to do. We have to start researching. And Dr. Finch, I think we covered some anthropology here. I think Dr. Finch's book, The Echoes from the Old Black Land, all right, is an excellent book that covers some of the things with Genesis as well as anthropology. These are books that we've got to, you know, keep on our shelf and start to read. A lot of these books are hard to get because we're not reading anymore, and it's costing thousands of dollars now, in some cases, to get these books printed, Brother Carl.
Let's go up to the Bronx. Carl's waiting for us on line one. Carl, your question for Brother Kwesi.
Hi, good afternoon, gentlemen. Good afternoon, Brother Kwesi.
Good afternoon. How are you?
I'm good. I'm good. And yourself?
Great. Hey, brother, that rose like the sun to live again, brother. You know, resurrection.
I hear that, brother.
Spring solstice. They call it Easter.
Thank you. I hear that.
Okay.
My question is a short one. Basically, in regards to the black church in America, what is your take on the black church in America and the hold that it seems to have on so many of our people?
Well, again, in many cases, the black church is controlled by the white church. All right. That's why I say you got to go to a white seminary school to learn a white theology. In many cases, not all cases, but in most cases, many preachers got to come back to our community to teach us a white theology. That's why he who circumscribes your circumference determines the diameter of your thinking. So our thinking is still within the circumference of that white theology. That's all we know. Again, when we look at those liberating ministers, the Gabriel Prossers, the Nat Turners, or the Henry McNeil Turners, these brothers understood the ancient African black divinity. You know, they were talking about a black Jesus way back then. All right, and at least bringing us to the space and place of a spirituality of our black divinity. And the question we got to ask, how do we break from the tradition of having freedom of thought, especially the freedom to go into our ancient African ancestral knowledge instead of having fear of ourselves? And I think this is what we're suffering at today. They've taught us to be afraid of ourselves and afraid of our spiritual knowledge that they themselves have benefited from and have used their Christianity is a white supremacy Christianity for imperialist world conquest, and that's what they have done to it and made people to believe that God has made them in their image, and anybody else that's saying anything other than this is pagan and heathen and doomed to hell. This is the sad thing, and preachers preach this for the most part to get, you know, a lot of the money, okay, from the parishioners who they put the fear of that they're going to be burned forever and ever, that I talked about earlier, and on and on and on.
All right. Thanks, Carl. Don is waiting for us in D.C. Don, your question for Brother Kwesi.
Brother Kwesi, is there, with what you're talking about, Easter, will that come under a book of symbolism or some is
there
this stuff?
There's many. I think that the key book to get would be Peace Be Upon Him, a good friend of mine, Shaka Musa Bar Shango, African People and European Holidays, A Mental Genocide. I think that's a great book to get on the origin of these holidays.
African People and the European Holidays.
By Shaka Musa Bar Shango. What city do you live in?
Washington, D.C.
Oh, you should be able to go right to Baltimore to
African People and European Holidays.
By Dr. Shaka Musa Bar Shango.
Okay, African People, European Holidays. Thank you.
A Mental Genocide. That's what it's
and mental genocide.
No, that's the whole the name of it. African People and European Holidays, A Mental Genocide. Everyone's
right.
Place. I'm sorry, that's the name of the bookstore. Everyone's Place.
Okay.
Everyone's Place in Baltimore.
All right, thanks, Don. Thanks for your call. Brother Kwesi, with all these holidays coming up, what do you think for black folks, why are we so locked into believing it? And it seems like we are afraid to release some of the knowledge that you're pouring into our brains right now.
Carl, this is all we have known, okay? These are European traditions that we played out even on the plantation, all right? As I said before, we were not allowed to speak our own language. They took away our names. We were not even allowed to play the drum. If we got caught teaching or sounding like we were even speaking an African language, we were whipped. Okay, so they whipped Africa out of us. They whipped our culture out of us. They whipped our names away from us. Remember his roots, Kunta Kinte. Okay, they whipped him till he was Toby. So then they replaced all that with their stories and their holidays and their traditions. And Easter, we dealt with Christmas, and we've been dealing with this, Carl, from been on your radio show from the days of Los Angeles, Stevie Wonder Station way back in the early 90s, okay? And I'm honored to be on your show for all these years to deal with these holidays because they're a critical time that our people are caught in the matrix of white supremacy. And we get caught up in it. You know, the rabbit, the eggs, as I said myself as a child, you know, I loved that period. You know, I have a basket with some eggs and chocolates and Easter egg hunt, but we didn't know. Our mothers and fathers didn't know. You know, they didn't teach us about these things. We had to go research. We didn't have institutions teaching us unless we had a conscious community. In many cases, we don't have, all right, to teach this. So we're caught up in it. So, of course, I know people hearing me for the first time talking about this, then, you know, it's the eyebrow raisers, you know, those who may just got on the show and I talked about Easter earlier. It's a Greek Orpheus holiday where the Greek female would take off all their clothes and paint themselves and run and hide. And the Greek males would go and hunt for her.
and they would have sex and fornication because they thought that's how spring came back. That's how nature came back. And they had rabbits with them because the rabbit is the one animal that has the most proliferation through sex. So they would have all this fornication and sex, and because the rabbit is born with his eyes wide open, it represented the moon. That's why March 23rd is the full moon. Go outside at night. You're going to see the moon getting larger and larger. How do you know what day is Easter? Because Easter is on a different day every year. Sometimes it's in April. Sometimes it's in March, because it always follows the first full moon after the spring solstice. That first Sunday is always Easter. When we dealt with December and Christmas, we know that's the birth of the sun at December the 25th. So this is how we know when Easter is. So, again, I have the calendar that got the full moon on it. And there it is right there in the calendar. But, again, people don't they don't look at these things. It's based off of a solar as well as a lunar events that our ancestors told the story thousands of years ago around these celestial events, Brother Carl.
How can folks get, because you laid a lot out today. Do you have any DVDs, any books or anything where people can?
People can go to my website. That's Kemet Nu. It literally translated, black people, Kemet Nu, K-E-M-E-T-N-U, KemetNu.com. And there you'll see our DVDs on there that way in depth. Okay, I'm visual. I'm at the temples, at the monuments, and I'm live at the lectures, Origin of Christianity, Origin of Civilization, and Mary Ra, her DVDs are on there. With a quick synopsis about them. If you want more information, you can call us at 214-371-0206. Okay. Then also our annual trips to Kemet, we do every summer. This is going on to 35 years of my life, going back 14 years, acknowledging the Grandmaster Teacher, Dr. Yosef Inyakin, and we affectionately know as Dr. Ben. Spent 14 years with him doing field research. Haven't missed a year since 1981 traveling with him, Carl. So this year we got two tours. The first one is July 16th to July 30th, and the second one is July 30th to August 13th. So we had so many people who were calling in. The first tour filled up, and now we're going into the second tour. That's July 30th to August 13th. And Ethiopia, we do annually. Every year we go to Ethiopia, and our Ethiopia tour is only December the 28th.
We're just out of time. You got like 10 seconds.
Ashra and Mary Ra Kwesi are lecturers on African history, civilization, religion, and culture. The duo present lively and dynamic presentations and video productions based on their extensive study and travel on the African continent. These national and international lecturers also conduct the annual Kemet Nu Know Thyself educational tours to Egypt and Ethiopia. Brother and Sister Kwesi link the historical with the present by means of visual documentation to bring our story to life. For lectures, videos, audio media, or Egypt and Ethiopia tour brochures, contact Ashra or Mary Ra Kwesi at Kemet Nu Productions, 214-371-0206. That's 214-371-0206. Or visit www.kemetnu.com. That's KEMETNU.com.